Hello, everybody. Welcome to Kickstarter's Creator Hangout. It's a weekly series that we have here where we have Q&A with some of our creators from our community. I'm Haley Rosenblum. I'm the music outreach lead here at Kickstarter. And today we're chatting with Rob Moose, an instrumentalist, arranger, producer. He has played violin, guitar, and has worked with so many wonderful artists, including Antony and the Johnsons, Sufjan Stevens, Ben Folds, Bon Iver, and is the co-founder of contemporary sextet ensemble yMusic, which has funded two albums on Kickstarter and will be joining us today to chat about them. Hey, Rob.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Of course, thanks for joining us. I'm very stoked to chat with you and hopefully get some insight and advice that we can share with musicians and other creative types out there that are looking to bring their work to life, either Kickstarter or just generally in the world.
Yeah.
So for those of you watching in live, you can submit some questions for Rob via our G Plus Google Hangout, our Kickstarter account that is on Twitter, at Kickstarter Tips, or on our Facebook page. And then for those of you who are tuning in the future, while this is recorded, these channels are also great places to get advice and tips after the fact as well. So submit your questions and hopefully we'll get them in our chat. But meanwhile, I'm just gonna ask some questions of my own. So.
Sweet.
Rob, you've had two Kickstarter campaigns, one in 2011 and one in 2013. And I just kind of wanted to hear your thoughts about what the differences were, what your experiences were like doing two, and if what you learned from one. Just kind of walk us through your decision to do two campaigns.
Yeah, I thought you were going to ask me why we haven't done one in 2015 yet.
There's plenty of time.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think that, yeah, there were definitely differences with the two campaigns. I mean, we had a great experience the first time. So when we were going to make the second album, it was a natural thought to consider doing it again. The first time that we did it, we didn't really know anything about, honestly, about making an album with our group or about really funding it. And I had never heard of Kickstarter at that point. And someone from the group suggested that we look into it. And it was a great experience. I think, you know, we were delighted to find out that there were people out there who would be interested in this thing that we were going to make, even though we didn't quite know exactly what it was going to be yet. And I guess there was a certain point when our project got kind of put on the front page. And I remember I was actually in Wisconsin with CJ, the trumpet player, and we were rehearsing for the Bon Iver tour. And one day we just were getting a lot of money on the thing. We're like, what happened? It was really exciting to kind of keep going and checking our computers or whatever between rehearsal sessions. And so we were successfully funded and got to make an album in a really special way. We were thrilled about and we're still really proud of that work. And then we, a couple of years later, had enough material to make another record and decided to try it out again. And what we found, as far as one trend, was just that there were a lot more people who participated in the campaign in smaller ways, such as kind of basically just like pre-ordering the music, using it as a way to kind of say, I want to own this, but, you know, and I'll help you by buying it now before it exists. So there were more people. I can't remember the differences in amounts that we raised, but the trend was more people supporting in modest ways, which is totally cool. And I think it's just a great way to kind of obviously to fund and be able to make something, but also to create a sort of a community of people who are going to be interested in your final product. So we had a great experience both times.
Absolutely. And you mentioned being on tour with Bon Iver at the time of the first campaign. And I know that you're on tour right now and going to be going on tour, I think, in a couple of days. You're on the road right. A lot. And having seen you perform live, I have to say that your live experience is definitely something that adds to who yMusic is and what you guys do. In terms of having I guess classical music or music ensemble, how have you incorporated the live performance or the live aspect of what you do into an online campaign through Kickstarter reward tiers, through project updates, through the whole components of the online promotion?
Yeah, that was a challenge. It's something that we wanted to do, you know, just to show people what it kind of like looks like and feels like to make the music. And a big thing for our group in general is just the live energy, trying to channel the live energy of like a rock and roll or indie rock or whatever show into a more traditional chamber music, classical kind of tradition. And, you know, we all kind of have worked with a lot of bands and want that feeling that you have when you go to the Bowery Ballroom and see a rock band and sweat it out and get beer spilled on you or whatever. Not the beer part, but just the sort of visceral kind of like, God, this could be the last night of my life. You know, like that kind of joy that you get and the sense of participation as an audience member, like you can shout something out or you know, that there's an energy going both ways. That's a big part of our aesthetic, no matter how complex or fragile the music is that we're playing. So we've always tried to keep that in mind with our live shows. And I remember when we were making the second record, we got to use Trey Anastasio from Fish. He let us use his barn in Vermont. That's a recording studio to make this record, Balance Problems, because I had worked with him on a few of his solo records. And it had this really cool like catwalk thing over top that you could kind of go up and they could put microphones there. And somebody went up and took a video of the string players playing one of these pieces that we recorded, the Andrew Norman Music in Circles. And it was a really rad video, just seeing us like shredding away from above. And so things like that, we tried to share, you know, snapshots and little videos of the recording process. It's hard to take yourself out of the discipline of recording to kind of, capture what you're doing for other people. And I think I could definitely see in the future, you know, kind of having someone on hand to do stuff like that, because I mean, it's great for me to take a picture from my seat of the woodwinds or something, but it's hard to remember to do that. And I think it's more and more important these days to like be documenting everything and sharing on social media. But you also are the ones doing the thing. So, you know, it's a challenge, but we do like being able to share sort of insider view of our ensemble with people.
Well, leading off of that, I know that entrepreneurship and kind of maintaining creative control of what you do is very important with your music and your career. Can you speak to the idea of working together? So the ensemble, for those who don't know, yMusic is of six people. Can you speak to what it's like to work in a group and how you kind of delegate the different tasks of promoting a work, recording, just working together in a team? I think for musicians that are using the internet, sometimes you notice that one person shines through as, okay, I'm the social media manager, or right. I'm the email replier, that kind of thing. Can you talk about how you guys as a team have worked together to delegate the different tasks of not just the Kickstarter campaign, but of existing of an online presence?
Absolutely. We're still learning about the best ways to delegate and to maximize everyone's kind of potential and interest within the group. I mean, I think the worst thing is giving someone a task that they're not super equipped to do or interested in doing. And so it's been an ever evolving process, but we're getting pretty good. As you mentioned, there are six of us, and two of us, myself and CJ, kind of came up with the idea of starting this group back in 2008. And so we kind of consider ourselves like the managers of the group. And since we don't have management, we have agents who book our concerts, but we sort of, we're emailing each other all the time and texting each other on the phone. And we try to have kind of weekly meetings with our computers where we just like go over the list of things that need to happen. And it's very unglamorous. We get a smoothie and, you know, we try to, you know, trick ourselves into thinking that we're not doing work. But so it kind of starts from there, like we're the sort of central branch of the thing. And then the other people in the group, Nadia, our violist, who is also kind of a well-known like radio personality and just she's a fantastic person, strong personality. She kind of writes all of our blurb type stuff, like whenever if we're going to play a concert and someone needs to know what are we going to do, or we're trying to get a residency at a university. She's just so great at like the stuff just flies off her fingertips, and it's magic. So we're kind of astonished by her ability to do that. So oftentimes I'll say, hey, can you salvage this press quote that they're trying to do for us? And you know, 10 minutes later, it comes back. So that helps in terms of our presentation in a verbal sense. That's really key. Alex, our flute player, is an awesome visual artist and actually did the album cover for the Ben Folds collaborative record that we are touring on now that came out in September. So so if we're going to do photos or have get merch made or anything like that, she's kind of like the visual person that we make sure that she kind of gives a final sign off to that. Our clarinet player Hideaki is into doing like boring organizational tasks,
Oh, I'm so lucky. You're so
yeah,
lucky.
We got one. So he does the grant writing. I think he just sort of saw like a vacuum where we're able to fund things by saving money from concerts that we play and kind of conserving funds in that way. But a lot of groups are nonprofits and run fully on grants and things like that. And we don't necessarily want to operate completely that way and have to kind of have like a board and do all this stuff. But there are grants that are available for groups like us, even if it's just a few thousand dollars to help commission a piece. So he's kind of taken that under his wing. Nadia writes the stuff and he kind of tells her, hey, it's due tomorrow. And he does all the, you know, the applications. And our cellist Gabe is new to the group as of last year. And we're not really sure what his role is yet. We're trying to just let him kind of feel his way in and enjoy himself. But he is about 10 years younger than the rest of us. And so I think his default role is just like, hey, you're young. Like, what do you think about this? Which is a really great perspective to have because most of us are 32, 33. And while we still consider ourselves like relatively young, we've been doing this for 10 years, you know? And so there are things that are happening that we're not like at the center of the pulse of the thing at this point. So it's good to have some young energy around us too.
Absolutely. I just want to remind our audience that if you guys have any questions for Rob, you can shoot them over through the G+ Google Hangout. You can shoot them over to us on Twitter at Kickstarter Tips, that's our account, or on Facebook, the Kickstarter Facebook page or the event page that we have right now for the Hangout. So going back to our chat, the commercial break over of interaction. yeah, it's kind of fascinating that you have distinct personalities in your group and you form this one unit, the band, mm-hmm. the ensemble. In terms of creative decisions and deciding to use Kickstarter or deciding to do a particular project or work with a particular musician, do you find that the collaboration that you do internally as yMusic is what leads you to do collaborations, I guess, outside of yourself? So I suppose the question really is to walk us through how you decide to take on any particular project at a time, because time is finite and you can't do everything, although it seems that you do everything because you do a lot. But how do
everything
you decide?
Everything minus one, yeah.
Exactly. How do you decide as a group to collaborate and to work with others?
A lot of times, the group is very active, especially the last few years. We've gotten more opportunities to perform on our own and stuff. But we never wanted to be strictly like a full-time group. A lot of string quartets, their goal is to be able to go play 100 concerts a year and be in residence at a school. And for us, we really value the diversity of all of our individual careers. And we feel like it keeps everyone happy and also continually enriched and brings new energy back to the group. So we want to work together and we love the opportunities that we have, but we also try to preserve everyone's kind of free time to do other things. And as a result of all those other things, we get to meet different people and they often hear about the group and are interested in working with us. So it can be completely random. Like Ben Folds heard about us through a mutual friend who shared our second record balance problems with him before it came out. And he got CJ's phone number and texted him and said, hey, this is Ben. And I'd love to, next time you're in LA and have a day off, I'd love to take you out for coffee and talk about doing something. And CJ was on tour with Paul Simon, literally in LA that day with a day off. And so they met up and had lunch. And then about 9 months later, after various texts and emails, we finally got in a room together. And like 6 months later, we were finished with an album, you know? So that's one example where it's almost like a pretty loose connection, just sort of through a mutual friend. But through playing with Bon Iver, we got to perform at the Eau Claire's Festival this past summer and work with a few of the bands there. And as a result, we are going to be doing a show in December with The Tallest Man on Earth at Zankel Hall. He's actually kind of going to be a guest on one of our shows. So just sort of like, yeah, okay, we were in Bon Iver for that touring cycle, and then we're part of this festival, and people see us play, and you know, just think, well, they could do that with our music. So, and there's examples of other people in the group as well, having connections to people who then want to work with us. And I think if one person in the group knows someone and feels like it would be a good idea to work together, then we all respect that and kind of try to find out more about how that would work. And in some cases, it's completely random. We're doing a tour with Jose Gonzalez in March, and we were just put together with him by Lincoln Center, who we were doing a residency with, and they wanted to have us at Lincoln Center Outdoors, and we all the people we asked weren't available. We didn't know Jose. And they said, well, Jose played last year and he was great. What if we introduce you to him? And it was a great show and we're going to do more of it. So, we have an open relationship with each other, and we bring all of our lovers back to the den, I guess.
Exciting. So in terms of starting a new project, an album of your own, I know that when you work with respected names out there, perhaps, you know, you're in the background, not necessarily introduced as yMusic, as mm-hmm. the unit yourself, as a unique artist yourself, but just kind of the sort of auxiliary musicians in a way.
Yeah.
It can be difficult to put your foot forward and say, if you like what you heard, where we have these albums, we do these work, and kind of put yourself forward. So in terms of promoting your own projects, sharing your own projects as the ensemble yMusic, as unique artists in and of yourselves, and not just Bon Iver's backup band or Ben Folds' backup band, and I say this with no disrespect, of course. How do you find, do you find any challenges promoting your work as the artists of yourself in your own name when you collaborate with so many people?
Definitely. I think it's sort of our versatility and ability to blend into what these artists are doing is kind of a double-edged sword, because people don't think of us as this extra ensemble on stage. It really, we integrate, you know, and mm-hmm. we make up a core part of the sound. So I think people just be like, wow, that was great what you did with Ben Folds. I'm going to go buy that album. But that's not our album. I mean, it is, you know, we had a big part of it, but it's, like you said, it's the same thing as our own music that we've financed and you know, created and stuff. So we're working on it. It's challenging. One thing we're going to try to do on this upcoming tour that I'm excited about is we got tote bags made. We're going to put our merch in the tote bags, and as soon as the concert's over, we're going to go to like the nearest bar to the venue. Because people kind of like, when they see a concert, they sort of leave, and there's a merch table, but it's kind of hard to engage. And for us, it's a little bit sad to come off stage and that whole concert experience, you know, just being so fresh and then kind of wait and see if somebody's going to come talk to you at a table. So we actually are having these postcards made. We're going to put them on tables in the venues and hand them out however we can. That'll basically say like, hey, what are you doing later? And you flip it over and it's like, come join us at, and we can fill in the bar in the city, and you know, and we'll have merch with us, and you can have a drink, and we'll sign your CD and whatever. Just to try to kind of do like a guerrilla campaign of what we would want to do after a concert is go hang out with each other and have a drink, and we can invite, in the spirit of kind of social media and like transparency and letting everybody in on all different windows of your life. I think it might be a cool way to say like, come actually meet us, talk to us about your experience with the show. And, you know, have a beer and then take this tote bag home. It's like a Christmas stocking. It's, you know, $20 or whatever to have all of the records we've made and this cool bag. And and hopefully that's a way, a slightly less formal and kind of at odds with the show kind of feeling way of actually meeting people and leading them back to our own music. Ben's a great advocate for us, and he speaks about us all the time. In interviews and from the stage, but we're also not an opening act, so it's a little bit, we never have a platform to speak during the show ourselves. So I think this kind of way might be a new opportunity to actually connect with people directly.
So you always have to think outside the box and how you promote your work, but not just promote your work, actually connect with your audience and kind of, I suppose you're creating a new opportunity to connect with them, and it's at the bar with some merch in hand, but create more meaningful connection than the, oh, nice to meet you. Yep, CD's $10. Like you're creating a
Yeah, you know, because when you're at that table, you always see there's people behind waiting to talk, and it's like, and those, the people who are trying to talk to you feel awkward about these other people, and it's just, it's not necessarily meaningful, but if we're just at a table and there's pitchers of beer and, you know, we're going to be there regardless, I think hopefully it's a more welcoming environment. And we'll definitely have to use social media a lot to get the word out about this. So it's a completely new model. I don't know of anyone who's done this. I'm sure there are people who've done it, but I just sort of thought of it, like, how can we make this more fun, feel less like work? And if it feels less like work for us, then maybe it'll be a more valuable experience for the audience member, and you know, it's kind of lets you know like what we're about, who we are.
Totally. And I guess to kind of steer it back to Kickstarter, only in the sense that I'm sure that there's musicians and artists watching right now that are trying to think, how do they set themselves apart? How do they get people to feel that they're connecting with them through Kickstarter and through their online sort of interactions and not just offline? Can you kind of talk us through how you thought about the pre-planning of your campaigns, either one or both, just kind of what kind of thoughts you had and maybe even some of your anxieties and concerns that you had, like, oh, is anyone going to back this? And then how you tackled through those concerns in the planning leading up to launch?
Trying to remember, I know that with the second one, we used the word classical. I think we said like an indie classical record. We either used the word classical and the word chamber music, and it was sort of a, you know, in the early stages of our group, we very much wanted to be like not a typical chamber ensemble, and you know, we're this group that works with bands, and our branding was more, and our understanding of ourselves was more this other thing attached to like a non-classical world. And in the years in between the records, we came to terms and got excited about the idea of playing within this chamber music classical kind of construct, but in the special way that we did because of all the experiences that we have. So I know that for us, that campaign was like kind of a moment where we were able to embrace a category in a way. And because there's all this talk of, you know, musical boundaries being blurred and there's no categories, and I totally support that and get where that's coming from. But at a certain point, is it any more valid to say I'm not in a category than it is to say I'm in this category, because the non-category becomes its own category? So what I'm trying to say is that I think it helped, the process of doing the campaign helped us realize kind of where we were situated, and we felt comfortable saying, you know what, we're doing a very unique thing within this realm, and if you like, If these words don't scare you and are in mildly interesting to you, then come check us out. And so in a way, giving people some kind of grounding for what it is, not trying to be like so innovative at every little turn that you almost can't define what you're doing. It's good if you can still distinguish yourself within a category. I think it's clearer to the consumer. So that was one thing I think we learned from the campaign.
Definitely learning how to talk about your work and yourself and the whole picture, especially in a snapshot where it's like, okay, here's my elevator pitch of what we're making. Oh, it's a fantastic way of thinking about it. I just want to remind our audience that if you have any questions for Rob, you can shoot them over through Twitter at Kickstarter Tips or directly in the Google Hangout or on Facebook. And if you're watching the pre-recorded video in the future right now, you can look at these channels for more information on advice as well. And with that, we have a question from one of our viewers, Joshua K. He has a two-part question for you, Rob. First, he wants to know how you find inspiration to create the music that you make. And then the second part is, what do you do when you have writer's block? How do you get through that?
Well, I have the fortunate situation that I don't necessarily ever start from scratch. Much of my work as an individual and with yMusic is complementing, you know, songs or compositions that exist in some form and helping them get fleshed out further. And so it is a compositional process in the way that I go through, but I don't think of it that way. And I think that really helps me not feel intimidated by having to invent some sound. So I'm inspired all the time by the things that kind of come across my desk, people's songwriting and compositions from people who are not necessarily trained to be writing chamber music in a sort of formal way for an ensemble like ours. That's really why we invented the group, was to try to almost encourage people to write music and say, hey, there's no barrier here. Like, just put it down however you can, and we're going to make it come to life for you. And in fact, this week, we're premiering a piece on Friday night at New York Live Arts by an electronic musician named Paul Corley. And he just sent us all these audio files and had specific ideas about how he wanted them voiced to an extent. But then just kind of, I was able to just get on the computer and spend a number of hours kind of figuring out who can cover this and who can play that. And so it's a very fluid process. And I love the idea of someone trying something they've never done before, bringing their skills from one area into the chamber music and kind of revitalizing it. So, it just feels like a conversation, and in that way, it helps me be able to speak back. It feels more natural than just starting with a blank page and thinking, how am I gonna make something?
Absolutely, you have to start somewhere. I guess that's true in every component of sharing music. We're almost out of time, but not yet. So I just want to make sure that we get some kind of hard hitting information for the people who are like taking notes and ready to start their projects of their own. In terms of reaching a community and sharing your work and using Kickstarter as a way to connect with your audience when you had your campaigns going, what did you do to reach beyond your initial fans, the people that you know are going to support you, your friends, your parents, you know, that kind of thing? How did you share your work and get beyond just the close circle of friends?
Yeah, our group has always depended on the kindness of strangers. Our group has always depended on the network of people that we work with, sort of as individuals to either collaborate with as singers who want instrumentalists with them or to write music for us. So we definitely leaned on some people and said, can you help spread the word about this campaign? You know that group that you think is interesting and that you sung with at one time, like, we're trying to make this thing. And I think people were excited by the idea of us coming from being a collaborative auxiliary group, as you said earlier, and doing something on our own, you know, sort of like the going solo notion of it. Was exciting for people who have been through that themselves. And so I know that we were able to get the word out on social media via some people with more followers and bigger names and stuff, and that definitely helped. Otherwise, I was just kind of emailing my mom, being like, tell people at your office.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, with one of your projects, I think it might have been your first campaign, you had Annie Clark of St. Vincent, Sharon Warden, My Brightest Diamond, a whole bunch of different collaborators that you're working with, but then incorporated into the reward tiers through autographed CDs, the videos.
That was a funny story, yeah.
Oh, please.
I remember one day I had to go all around town and get all these people's signatures. You know, you're making these rewards and you don't necessarily think, how will we fulfill them? And so I remember meeting Annie for breakfast or something in the West Village, and then having to go and find Sun Lux and Shara. And then we had to mail the CDs because certain people live in other places. I think we didn't offer that option for the second record because it was sort of fun. I wish we had made a short film about that. You know, just like Rob gets on the subway and tries to get signatures from famous people who are busy.
As they're going to board their flight, you're like, okay, sign right
now. Yeah, no, totally. It's like it's so hard even for everybody who lives here, we're not here very much, you know, so.
Yeah, that's a good takeaway. So I'll throw in my expert hat. If you're planning your reward tiers or any sort of merchandise or product that you want to deliver, think about what it will entail for you to fulfill. So if it's manufacturing an album or a record and test pressings, think about all of that. If you're promising autographs, think about what it will take to get them signed.
The other thing we struggled with was our delivery time on, I think, the second record, because we felt like we had something really special on our hands and wanted to make sure that we found the right home for it. People actually contributed. I mean, I think it took many months to get it to them. I think it was our second one. And I know that that can be a frustrating thing. So we had to really write a lot of emails and make sure everybody knew this is still happening. And
right. The communication is so key. So we're just about out of time. Before we wrap up, I guess the ending question is always the great padded end question. Do you have any sort of general tips or advice or inspiration to offer folks who are interested in starting their own music project and collaborating with people and just really putting themselves out there, be it on Kickstarter?
Yeah, I guess I would say something that's been helpful for me is just to keep a running list of every idea I ever have just in the notes on my iPhone. Just anytime I'm on the subway thinking about spacing out and kind of think of something, just keep, for me, it's actually words that I hear people say, little phrases that I think could be interesting to try to write instrumental music inspired by. So just kind of keep track of everything and document everything. There's a process of just making things external for yourself and for the people who might be interested in you that I think is important. Don't feel that you can get bogged down by having everything in your head, and it can be daunting to think of where to start, but if you just sort of put it down somewhere, I think it's that much closer to becoming real.
Absolutely. That's fantastic advice. I want to thank you, Rob, for joining us. I want to thank our viewers for joining us and the future viewers. Thanks for watching this right now. You guys can find Rob on the internet on Twitter. He is Moose, M-O-S-E, of Rob on Twitter. yMusic is also on Twitter at yMusic NYC. You can also follow Kickstarter on Twitter, Kickstarter, and our account Kickstarter Tips on Twitter is where we'll give you advice. We'll be posting links to our hangouts and things like that. And of course, we're on Facebook. I found yMusic on Facebook, yMusic Ensemble. And I just want to thank you, Rob. Thank you so much for all the advice. We appreciate you taking the time to chat with us today.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thanks for having me. All right.